gentlemen. So what I'm going to cover in today's presentation, I'll briefly speak about CIBIL. I'll speak about what a CIBIL report and a CIBIL TransUnion score is. I'll try to decode the score. I will speak about when you look at your own report, if there are discrepancies, if there are issues, how do you go about resolving those issues, how do you raise disputes, and what are the misconceptions or myths that are there in people's mind. A lot of times we hear things about, you know, CIBIL is a defaulters list, mera naam CIBIL mein aa gaya, abhi main kya karu. So there are a lot of these misconceptions which are there in people's minds. So I will try to demystify some of them in my session today. So let me begin by speaking about CIBIL. What is CIBIL? So CIBIL was established in 2001. We are a credit information company. We collect information about all the loans and all the credit cards that have been issued by the banks, financial institutions, and this information is collected by us on a monthly basis. So we have over 2,000 credit institutions as members of CIBIL, and by being members of CIBIL, they give us information on all their loans. They give us information about all the credit cards that they may have issued, and this information comes to us on a monthly basis. So individuals like us who've taken loans, irrespective of the type of loan that they've taken, irrespective of the amount of loan that we may have taken, that information comes to us. Whether we are paying on time or defaulting, that information comes to us. So this is very important to note, that positive information is also something that comes to us. So when a lot of people come and tell us that, you know, my name has come in CIBIL, or what should I do, they think that this is like a taboo that their name is there in CIBIL. But here I would like to say and like to address that we have information about anyone who's taken a loan. We have information about anyone who's ever taken a credit card. We have information on over 500 million accounts, and it's nothing bad, it's nothing wrong. We will have your information, and there's nothing to be fearful about if your information is there with CIBIL. As individuals' information is there, similarly non-individuals, so let's say partnership company, proprietary concern, private limited companies, public limited companies, that information also comes to us. So information taken by, say, I run a small shop or I run my own business and I have taken loans for my business, that information also comes to us. Or I have like a private limited company or partnership company, that information will also come. But what information comes, it's all about loans. Loans that this company would have taken, or loans that this business person for his proprietary concern that would have taken, that information comes to us. And on the corporate or the commercial side, which is mostly SME and MSME data that we have information on over 22 million accounts. And this information comes to us by banks and credit, through banks and credit institutions, and gets updated on a monthly basis, because it's not just important for us to have this information as a static basis, but it's very important for us to make sure that this information is updated on a monthly basis. Because what is the latest status? If I've taken a loan, whether I've paid on time, not paid on time, that's very important to us. So data gets submitted to us on a monthly basis. Typically, a bank would take anywhere between 2 weeks to 4 weeks to give that information to us, and that information gets updated by us, or that information gets uploaded by us in a matter of 2 to 3 days, this information gets updated. So when we are speaking about 500 million accounts, that means 500 million accounts get refreshed every month. Not all banks will send us data on, say, 5th of the month or 6th of the month. The data keeps coming to us on daily basis. Data gets refreshed every minute as we speak. It's like a constant joke that we have with our CIO, that the number of employees that we have are probably lesser than the number of servers that we have, because this information has to get updated on a regular basis. This information, we have to ensure that we have our turnaround times, that the data gets updated faster. We also have to ensure that the reports that go out to the banks also go out faster. So turnaround time is very critical for us. From an information perspective, complete information, updated information, comprehensive information is very critical. So if I've taken 4 loans from 4 different institutions, how do we make sure that, you know, one, all those get reported to CIBIL? Second is, when a report is asked, say for a Harshala, how can all those 4 be put together in 1 credit report and be sent out to the bank or to the consumer who's asking for that particular information? Now, very briefly, I will cover on what is there in the credit report. Broken down into three, four sections. The first one is the Civil TransUnion score. Civil TransUnion score is a three-digit number ranging from 300 to 900. And it's a statistically derived number based on information which is there in the credit report. So what loans has the consumer taken? When have the loans been taken? Have payments happened on time? Whether the defaults have happened, whether they have happened in the recent past, or whether they have happened maybe 2 years back. All that information is used, and it is statistically, the number is statistically derived using information which is there on the credit reports. I'll speak more on the score in my later slide. But if I have to very, very in simple terms explain what is a score and what is a credit report, I will take this analogy. Like when we were in school and colleges, we used to get our report card. So the report card is basically your detailed credit report, which has information on all the loans that you may have taken, all the credit cards that you have taken. And the score is basically the grade that you got. So that's the simple analogy that I would like to make, that your credit report is the report card that we got in our school and colleges. And the grade is basically the score, which is a number that we gave. I think as Indians, we tend to be a lot number centric, and you know that's why the score is very, very much more meaningful for the consumers, and that's what they keep asking us, or they keep, when they're speaking with each other, they say, what is your score? So that's very important. So that's basically a summary of information which is there on the credit report. The next section in the credit report is information about that individual. So personal information, name, address, date of birth, identification numbers, be it the income tax number, be it the voter's ID number, the passport number, Aadhaar. We've started getting information about Aadhaar as well for the past couple of years. So all that information is there in the personal information section. We have addresses. The system has the capability of storing n number of addresses. So if I have given my home address for one loan application, or if I've given my office address, say for my credit card application, because I prefer my credit card bill to come to my office, that address, or maybe I've changed residences, I've changed cities, I've moved cities, all that information, n number of addresses get stored in the system. What gets reflected on the credit report is the latest four addresses. Similarly, on the telephone number, all the telephone numbers that I've used in the past get accumulated and stored in the database. Again, what gets reflected is the latest ones which get reflected on the credit report. The next section, which is the most important section in the credit report, is the account information section. And this section gets repeated number of times as many loans and credit cards that you may have. So if I have, say, four credit cards, account information section will get repeated four times. Or if I have two credit cards and three loans, then five times this information, account information section will get repeated. And what does this show? It gives details about, particulars about the loan that I've taken. So let's say if I have taken, in this example, it is an auto loan which that individual has taken. So from which bank has the individual taken that loan from? What is the type of loan? What is the amount of loan that was sanctioned to me? What is the current balance? If I've taken a loan 1 year back and I've paid my EMIs for the last 12 months, what is the current balance which is remaining to be paid back to the bank? That comes there. Then comes the ownership indicator. Now, this is very important, and a lot of people have a lot of queries on this. I have taken a loan in my individual name, single, it's an individual loan, let's say this auto loan. So that's an individual loan that gets reported. Now me and my husband have taken a joint home loan. That home loan will get reported on both the accounts. So my credit report will have that loan reported. My husband's credit report will also have that loan reported. This is very important. Though let us say in this case, the responsibility of paying the EMIs is, say, mine or my husband. So let's take in this example, it's my husband's responsibility to make payments to the EMI. But it will still get reflected on my credit report. If there is a default which happens, the default will be shown on both the credit reports. So that's what gets reflected. Then guarantors. A lot of times people come, a friend will come or a relative will come or a, you know, someone will come and ask us, an acquaintance will come and ask us that the bank is asking for a guarantor. Sign kar do, kuch nahi hai, bas signature karna hai, mera loan ho jayega. And a lot of times people just blindly signed it. But the legal responsibility of the guarantor is that if you default on that loan, if the individual, not you, if the borrower defaults on the loan, the bank can reach out to the guarantor to make a payment. Hence, all the loans that have been guaranteed by an individual will also get reflected on the credit report. So this is very important and pertinent to note that ownership which is there in the first half, that reflects what is the ownership indicator of that loan. It's an individual loan, it's a guarantor, you've stood as a guarantor for that particular loan, or it's a joint loan that has been taken by you. Then when we move to the second slot, it is information pertaining to that particular loan. So as I said, what is the credit limit if it's a credit card, what is the sanction amount, what is the current balance, what is the rate of interest, what is the tenure of the loan, what is the EMI that I'm paying on a monthly basis. Information pertaining to all details about my loan get reflected here. If there are any defaults, that amount will show. What has been the amount overdue, that gets reflected. Then what you see towards the bottom section of the account information section is a 36 months history, payment history on that particular loan. How have I paid my loan in the last 36 months? So if I have been making payments on time, the days past due, DPD as it is very popularly called, will be zero. If I have missed one payment, one EMI, it will show 30 days past due. Next month, again I miss a payment, it will show 60 days past due. Third month, again I miss a payment, it will show 90 days past due. Fourth month, I have made the three EMIs that I have missed plus the fourth EMI, I have paid that amount, that 90 days will become 0 days. So when a bank is looking, or when a credit institution is looking at the report, they will see 30, 60, 90 and 0. That means there was a blip for those 3 months, but after the third month or in the fourth month, the payment has happened and hence it is 0. There are a lot of times that you may also see on your credit report an XXX, and a lot of times people ask us, what is this XXX mean? That means that for that particular month, we have not received the data from that particular bank. Hence, we don't have any information to represent on the credit report, and that's why it gets shown as XXX. So we don't have information, and hence it doesn't get reflected. So this is, in short, the account information section, and as I mentioned, it will get repeated for as many number of times, as many loans and credit cards that you have. The last section in your report is the inquiry information section. And what does this show? If I have applied to a bank for a loan and the bank has pulled my report, that transaction of basically the bank pulling my report will leave a footprint on the system, which is called an inquiry. So in this instance, let's say this particular member, say Bank of India, on a particular date has pulled a report for me because I had applied for an overdraft loan or I had applied for a home loan for this particular amount. So this shows the history of how many times was my report accessed by different banks. This is the information that gets reflected. Now, a credit information report which a bank accesses and what an individual accesses, look and feel is a little different. When a consumer is looking at his or her own credit report, it is represented in a more consumer-friendly manner. The report which a bank accesses is more cryptic because the terms and terminologies, they are more familiar with it. For a consumer side, it is made a little more consumer friendly. Second big difference is the names of the banks don't get reflected in the report pulled by a credit institution. So here in this report, you see the member name as Bank of India and OBC and ICICI Bank. In a report which is pulled by a bank or a credit institution, it will appear as not disclosed. Now that's an industry norm that is being followed, that when banks are pulling reports, they do not want the names to be disclosed, and hence it is not disclosed. But otherwise, the report, the information which is there on the credit report is identical because it is a common database which is used for reports which get generated for consumers and reports which get generated for individuals. So I have by and large covered in terms of what information is there in the credit report. Everything that you see on the credit report is what has been submitted by the banks and financial institutions. So I spoke about 2,000 members. These are banks, financial institutions, NBFCs, housing finance companies, cooperative banks, RRBs. So these are all the credit institutions who are members of CIBIL and who give data to us on a regular basis. And that's the information which gets represented in a credit information report. Now, it's also very important to note what is the information which will not get reported in a credit report. So your savings account information, we will not have any information pertaining to the savings account and savings accounts that you may have with the banks. Investments that you've made, whether it is mutual fund, whether it is stocks, whether it is insurance policies that you may have taken, any type of fixed deposits that you may have, we do not have any information on investments that you may have taken. Transaction details of your card. So suppose I have swiped my cards 4 times in 4 different locations, we will not have information on where has this consumer swiped his card. What we will get is end of the month balance, and we will get amount outstanding for that particular card. Other information in terms of different transactions that you may have made, we will not get that information. On credit card particularly, let's say my amount outstanding is 1,000 rupees, or that's what I have spent, say 10,000 rupees I've spent. My minimum amount due is say 250 rupees. If I make that 250 rupees payment and I've not made the other payment, it will not be shown as a default. I think this is also important to note. But as Suchita mentioned in her earlier session, is that the rate of interest that the consumer will pays on that balance amount is significantly higher. And secondly, when you start using that card, your rate of interest starts kicking in immediately. You don't get any credit period. That's also something which is very important for consumers to note. But from a reporting perspective, it doesn't. If you made a minimum due payment, it doesn't get reported as a default. So that's the way the reporting gets done for a credit card. Let me now move on to what is a CIBIL TransUnion score. So as I mentioned, it is a 3-digit number ranging from 300 to 900, and it basically predicts the probability of default. It is a statistical tool. It is based on information which is there on your credit report. Several characteristics are drawn from information which is there on the credit report, and a score is derived. And what are the key parameters basically which go into making of the score? As I mentioned, since it's a statistical model, I will not be able to say that these are the 10 things basically which are going to impact the score for this percentage. But broadly, I can speak about what is it it's going to impact the credit score in terms of the weightage. Past performance is the most important factor. If you've taken loans, how have you made payments on the loan is the most important thing. If you have defaulted, if the person has defaulted, that's going to be a factor which is going to have a significant impact on the credit score. The next is basically the type of credit. So secured loans versus unsecured loans. So unsecured loans tend to be risky loans, and that's the reason why the rate of interest that we pay for an unsecured loan is also higher than possibly what we pay for a secured loan. So home loans, auto loans, rate of interest tends to be lower than say a rate of interest that we pay for a personal loan or for a credit card. So what is the mix that I have in terms of secured loans versus unsecured loans? How many loans have I opened in the recent past? So let's take a person who's opened say 3 loans in last 2 months, as against a person who's opened 3 loans in maybe in a span of maybe 12 months or 18 months. The way the score will be calculated for a person, I mean, if you've taken or if you open loans in a short duration of time closer to when your report was accessed, that is going to have a significant impact than against a person who's taken maybe loans 12 months back or 18 months back. So I spoke about the recency of events, then the number of events, whether I've taken 2 loans or whether I've taken 4 loans or whether I've taken 5 loans. The number of events is also important factor in terms of calculation of the score. The next is leverage. How much debt do I overall have? That plays an important role. If I have a credit card, how much of the limit am I using on a month-on-month basis? That plays an important role. The other thing is, a lot of times consumers ask us queries that every time a bank accesses my report, there is an inquiry which gets made on the credit report. Does that bring down the score substantially? So the inquiries do have an impact on the score, but it is a very, very marginal impact that is there. If there are like you know, like more than 70-80 inquiries at that point of time, there will be an impact, but the impact is again very limited. It is not going to be significant impact. Secondly, when a consumer is accessing his or her own credit report, it doesn't leave a footprint on the credit report, and it doesn't bring the score down, because that's again a question which comes, that if I access my own report, will my score come down? So it doesn't have an impact. If you are accessing your own credit report, it doesn't have an impact. Again, a lot of times people ask us, find this range 300 to 900, but what is considered as a good score? Now, each bank has its own policy. Each bank will have a credit policy for the types of loans that they are basically disbursing. So the policy could be different for an auto loan as against a personal loan, or for, say, a home loan. Each bank will decide what should be a cutoff score for them. CIBIL doesn't prescribe that this should be a cutoff score for you, this should be a cutoff score for you. How much risk does the bank want to take? Depending on that, they decide a cutoff score. 700 could be a good cutoff score for bank A. Bank B may say no, 820. Anything below 820, we are not going to look at. But what we have typically seen is 750 and above is considered as a good score by most of the banks. And this is because what we see is close to 80% of the loans that have got sanctioned, because they get reported back to us, had a score of 750 plus. So this is by and large, banks will, by and large, we confidently say that 750 plus is considered as a good score. Having said that, does it mean that if I have a loan of, if I have a score of 700, I will never get a loan? No, it's not that. If you have a loan of 700, there may be a bank, or there may be an NBFC who will lend to you, but the terms and conditions that are there could be different. Maybe the rate of interest is different, maybe they may ask for an additional security, maybe they'll ask for a guarantor. Could be different. The product that you may get is different. Now, it's not. We are not saying that you will never get a loan if you are below 750. If you are, say, above 750, does that guarantee that you will get a loan? No. Again, it will not guarantee, because it depends on the policy of the bank. There are other parameters which a bank or a credit institution does look at when they are sanctioning the loans. A credit report and a score is one of the factors which they look at when they are sanctioning loans. It is an important factor, and today all banks, before sanctioning a loan or a credit card, will look at your report, will look at what your score is before they sanction. So it is become a very important factor in terms of deciding whether a loan should be given or not to be given. But it's not only basis the CIBIL report. There are other parameters which the bank will look at before they decide whether a loan should be sanctioned or it shouldn't be sanctioned. Countries where there are credit bureaus which have been established for many years. I mean, 2000 was when CIBIL was established, so we are still in a nascent stage, nascent industry, 15 years old, but it's really 7-8 years since we've started really offering a lot of services to the banks and financial institutions, and the banks have started using us. But countries where credit bureaus are there for more than 50 years, 60 years, everyone, I mean, an individual basically doesn't get access to credit cards or doesn't get access to loans if they don't have a CIBIL report if they don't have a credit report or a score. It's become that important. Again, a question which comes to us is, I don't have a loan, I have never taken a credit card, what report will CIBIL generate for me? We cannot report for an individual who's never taken a loan, who has never taken a credit card. We will not have information on that particular individual, so we will not be able to generate a report for this individual. Now, does that mean that the person gets denied a loan? No, it doesn't mean the person gets denied a loan. The policy for deciding whether a loan should be given or not to be given for such a kind of an individual is a different policy. So the bank will have different parameters to basically look at individuals who've never borrowed. So those are new to credit customers. Policies will be different. Banks will have different methodologies to basically assess risk of such individuals, and they will have a different policy. How can individuals like us access reports from a CIBIL? One is, of course, bank can access reports from us whenever there are credit applications made, whenever they want to look at the risk of their clients or customers, they access reports from us. But if I want to look at my own report, how can I do? So it is an online process where the consumer can go to our website and access his or her own credit report and score. There is a charge, there is authentication which has to happen. We've also recently launched subscription where I can get 4 reports in a year or 2 reports in a year. I go to the CIBIL website, I fill in information about myself which helps CIBIL to generate my report. There are authentication questions which are asked for that particular individual, and these are typically out of wallet questions which get asked, which bank have I taken a loan for, or if I have taken a home loan, what has been the amount that has been sanctioned, or which institution have I taken my credit card from. So these are out of wallet questions which typically only I will know. Once the authentication is successfully done, the report gets emailed out instantaneously to the consumer. It is available on the portal as well. If I fail authentication, then the consumer has to basically upload the KYC documents. So the address proof and the identity proof has to be sent to us, and once we get those documents, the report gets processed and sent out to the consumer. So this is an online process that consumers have to follow if they want access to their own credit report and score. There is an offline process as well. You can send us documents to our office and we will get it processed on an offline manner. Now, what are some of the myths or what are some of the perceptions that people have about CIBIL in their minds? A lot of times when consumers write to us, they send us queries, they come and meet us, what do they speak about? So as I mentioned, CIBIL is a defaulters list. That's a common thing that we hear, that we are a defaulters list. But as I mentioned earlier, we maintain both positive and negative credit information. 500 million accounts that we maintain are not just negative accounts, but people who are making payments on time, information about those loans, those credit cards also is there with us. CIBIL has rejected my loan application. So we don't take part in any acceptance or rejection, basically what happens. We give information, we give solutions, which the banks and credit institutions use to make a decision. So we give them information which helps them take decisions. I have been blacklisted by CIBIL. This is again something which we very commonly hear. Again, we don't blacklist or label anyone. Information as is given by the credit institution or by the bank gets reflected on the credit report. CIBIL should make changes on its own. So a lot of times when consumers raise disputes with us, they send us proofs of documents and they say that make the change on your own without waiting for the bank to confirm. We cannot make it because the information has been provided by the bank, and hence, changes can happen in the report only after the bank confirms that. So these are, again, some of the common things that we hear from consumers. The next one is, how do I get my account deleted from CIBIL? So a lot of times people say, I had taken this loan 2 years, 3 years back, and I've repaid it. Please delete it from my account, from my report. Again, accounts don't get deleted. If there are any errors in the account or if there are any discrepancies that you may see what has been reported for your particular account, that can get rectified, but we cannot delete any account. The bank will also not delete any account unless it is a account which has got wrongly tagged to your particular profile. That gets delinked, that doesn't get deleted, but it will get delinked from your account, but otherwise deletion doesn't happen, and it's not good for you also to get your account deleted. Let's take an example where I've taken an auto loan 5 years back and I've made payment on time for that auto loan, and last year I closed that auto loan. I've made complete payment every month, I've made payment on a timely basis. It shows positive credit history, and when it shows positive credit history, that means it helps me improve, one, my credit history, second, it also helps me improve my credit score. So it's always good to have accounts even they are if they are closed, because it shows positive history. I had taken a loan, I made payments on time. Always good to have positive accounts. So we would not recommend anyone to make a request that you get the account deleted. One is we cannot delete any accounts, and second is also it's good from a consumer's perspective to have that particular account. A lot of times you may see a 0 or minus 1 as the score which gets returned, especially for a report which has been accessed by a bank. Now, what does it mean? A 0 or minus 1 means that CIBIL has not been able to return a score for that particular individual, and it could be because you don't have any credit history, because you've not taken any loans or you've not taken any credit cards, or there isn't enough history available where we are able to score that individual. So if the history which is available is just for 6 months or 3 months, we are not able to basically predict it, and hence we are not able to return a score for that individual. Or if it is only add-on cards that you may have, so an add-on card is typically where I don't have the liability to make a payment, but the person who has given me the add-on card is making payments on my behalf. So my payment behavior cannot be predicted, because I don't have any accounts, I don't have any history where the payment behavior pattern has been established, and hence we are not able to generate a score for that particular individual. Now, 0 and minus 1 gets reflected on a report which is pulled by a bank. But when consumers pull their own report, because we do understand 0 and minus 1 tends to be cryptic. A lot of times people say, achha, 0 mil gaya mujhe score, aisa kaisa mera score 0 aa gaya. In terms of representation, when a consumer pulls his or her own credit report and score, it gets represented as NH or NA, that is no history or not available. It doesn't show as 0 or minus 1, but whenever the bank pulls a report, it will show a 0 or a minus 1. So if your bank has shared your report with you, and if you see a 0 or a minus 1, it just means that we are not able to generate a report. It doesn't mean that it is not good, or it is bad, or it's 0 mil gaya, like how 0 mil gaya like in exams or something like that. It doesn't mean that. We get a lot of disputes and queries about settled accounts. If you have taken a credit card, or if you have a loan which has not been paid fully and there has been a settlement which has happened, then that particular information will get reflected on the credit report. So the status field basically will show either as a written off account, or if it's a settled account, it will show as a settled account. So let's take an example where the amount which was outstanding was 100 rupees, and I settled for say 50 rupees, and the 50 rupees which the company or which the credit institution has written off will be shown as a settlement amount, and the settled flag will be there. So that's something which is very important to note, that will continue to be there on the credit report unless and until a full payment has been made and the bank decides to take that settled flag off your credit report, because now a full payment has happened on that particular loan. Secondly, it is also important that once this either the settlement has happened full, partial, the bank has to give the updated information to us. A lot of times consumers come back with a settlement letter and say that this is a settlement letter. While we can raise a dispute on behalf of the consumer, and we do that, we will do the coordination on behalf of the consumer to get the information updated, but the updated information has to come from the bank still before we can make a change in the credit information which gets reflected on the report. I have spoken about what type of loans get reported. So co-borrowers, if there are two joint loans, that will get reported on both the joint account holders. If you've guaranteed a loan, it will get reported. If a company which has taken loans and you've guaranteed it as a partner or a proprietor, again that gets reflected. So guarantees that have been given by you for any loans do get reflected. Joint loans do get reflected, and of course in loans that you've taken in your individual capacity also get reflected. So this is a very important to know here. Okay, moving on to how to correct inaccuracies in your credit report. If you have seen your credit report and if you see that there are inaccuracies, what should you do to basically get your inaccuracies corrected? Because inaccurate information could lead to inaccurate decisions being taken. So it's important for all of us to make sure that if there are any discrepancies in our credit reports, we should get it corrected. And what is the process of getting them corrected? So we have a dispute resolution mechanism in place. place where we will help consumers to get the inaccuracies which are there on your credit report corrected. You can log in your disputes that you may have on our website. Whatever information you are disputing, you must mention what that information is, that is being disputed. As soon as the dispute gets raised, the first thing which happens is it leaves a flag on that particular consumer's record saying that this particular account has been disputed by the consumer. Second thing which happens is that dispute gets sent to that respective bank for them to check in their records whether the information which has been reported is accurate or not accurate, for them to make changes if changes are required. Second is, if there is an incorrect account which has got tagged on to your particular profile because of maybe information that has got reported to us, or maybe because of errors that could have happened because of maybe the similar names or matching issues that could be there, and there have been incorrect linkages, that's an analysis that we will do, and we will dealing those two particular accounts. As I mentioned earlier, in terms of the information that we collect, so name, address, date of birth, identifiers. Now, why do we collect name, address, date of birth, identifiers of an individual? Is because these are pieces of information that we use to match different accounts and put them together in a single profile. When we started, India didn't have a unique identification number. Back in 2004, we didn't have any unique identification number. So we had to depend on a lot of surrogate information, that is name, address, identifier information like PAN address, voter's ID, driving license number. And looking at the surrogate information, we will look at the similarities and put accounts together. And we'll put, let's say if I've taken four loans from four different accounts, we will see what is matching. And if it meets the threshold criteria, accounts get put together in one credit report. Can errors happen? Yes, errors can happen, though they are very, very minimal. But I would not like to discount that, because the error which has happened for that individual, it's the most important thing. And for him, it is his record which has got tarnished. So we, from our side, look at the data, we look at our matching algorithm, we look at what can we do proactively to make changes in the data quality, to make improvements in our system, so such errors are minimized. So if a consumer has raised a query saying that this particular account which is getting reflected on my credit report is not mine, we will take steps to dealing that account, put that account in a separate profile if we find out that it's incorrectly linked. If it is an error pertaining to information which is reported by a bank, say, let's say my current balance is not correct, or I have closed this loan but close date has not been reported, or this account has not got updated for the last 1 year, those queries we will send to the bank for getting updates from the bank. Once the bank updates it, what happens is the dispute flag which is there will be taken off, updated information will get reflected on your credit report, and once all your disputes are resolved, we will send a copy of a updated credit report and score back to the consumer. So that's the cycle that we follow in terms of getting the queries resolved which have been raised by consumers. We are restricted in terms of making changes on our own. We have to wait for the banks to respond back before we can make the changes. But efforts from our side are that banks respond in a timely fashion, so that we are able to close disputes in a timely fashion. Again, a very common question that comes to us is, what should I do to improve my score? What should I do to improve my credit history? The first and most important, which I speak about at every session, is if you've taken loans, if you've taken credit cards, make sure you make payments on time. Because if there are defaults, that's something which is going to impact your score the most. Well, there can be situations where I've not been able to make a payment because I maybe have had health issues, I had a medical problem, I had a family emergency, and I've missed payments for the last 2 months or 3 months. What should I do? Once a defaulter is not an always a defaulter. Make sure that after you've overcome that difficult situation or that emergency, make sure you make payments on time on your loan obligations and credit cards. Build a good credit history for 6 to 9 months for the score to improve. Score is not going to improve instantaneously after 1 month. It has to have 3-4 months of positive history. Make sure you've started building your positive history for the score to improve. Third is, if you don't need that fourth credit card or fifth credit card, don't take it, because there are chances is that we've seen so many cases where there has been overspend which has happened on a credit card, and the person has got into a debt trap. So make sure that, you know, you borrow as much as one you need and as much as you are able to pay back. There should be a healthy mix of credit, secured loans versus unsecured loans. That's something which is very important. Again, as I mentioned, loans that you've guaranteed, if there are defaults which happen on that loan, that will also get reflected in your credit report, which will impact your credit score. So it's important to monitor that. And monitor, as we do health checkups on an annual basis, make sure that you do your credit or financial health checkup also on an annual basis. If not on an annual basis, at least before you're applying for a loan, make sure you have seen your credit report so that you know what is there in your credit report. And if there are any inaccuracies, if there are any disputes, you can get it corrected in a timely fashion. Thank you very much. I think this is what I had to cover from my presentation. Thank you so much.